Okay, so first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to come in and to present this work, which I did in collaboration with Anthony Valentini, who unfortunately could not attend the conference. So in the next four slides, I would like to set up the background for my talk, and hopefully, after these four slides, the title should become clear for everyone. So back in March 2013, the data collected by the Planck satellite had been analyzed and it was made public. And there was also a coverage in the television news. And the mission of the Planck satellite was to measure the temperature of the cosmic microwave background, which is a rather complex mission because the temperature is almost isotropic. So the mean temperature is about 2.72 degrees Kelvin. But you have some hotter spots, some colder spots, and the difference between them is really small. It's of the order of 10 microkelvins. So this map gives you some information on the universe as it was some 380,000 years after the Big Bang. So even if you go even before that, there was a plasma of highly energetic particles, electrons, protons, photons, and the atoms could not form. For instance, the hydrogen atom could not form because once the electron and the proton tried to combine together, the photon would be so energetic that it would be simply knock the electron out of the two-body system. But as space is expanding, the temperature of the radiation goes down, and you reach a stage in which you can have the formation of atoms. And then at this stage, the radiation is going to decouple from the matter. And that's the formation of the cosmic microwave background. So according to inflationary cosmology now, if you go in the very beginning of the universe, what you have is a field called the inflaton field. It's coupled to gravity. And you have a very short period of time. And after that, there will be a phase in which the scale of the universe is going to grow exponentially. And this phase of exponential expansion is driven by the energy density of the inflaton field. So this inflaton field, for later in time, is going to decay, produce particles. Then you will have the plasma of highly energy particles that I just mentioned before. And later on, you will have the formation of the cosmic microwave background. So what's interesting about inflationary cosmology is that the temperature anisotropies that you have in the cosmic microwave background are fully determined by the fluctuations of the inflaton field. And so you have a prediction, a theoretical prediction for the temperature anisotropies of the cosmic microwave background. So when you measure the temperature anisotropy, what you test is quantum theory itself. And of course, if you have a theory which gives you predictions which are different than standard quantum theory, this can be reflected in the measurement of the cosmic microwave background. So here, we have this single measurement of the temperature, which was provided by the Planck satellite. And you can also decompose it into spherical harmonics. So you have a set of coefficients. And in cosmology, it's assumed that this measurement of the temperature is a single realization of a stochastic process, P, which depends on T. And if this process is isotropic, you can further deduce that each of these coefficients, ALM, for a given L, is going to obey the same marginal distribution. So if you take this coefficient, and if you sum their norm squared, and if you average over them, what you define is a quantity called the angular power spectrum. And here you have another plot. And you see all these red dots. This corresponds to the data given by the Planck satellite. So for each multiple moment L, you average all the ALM squared, and you get the point on this picture. And you can compare the experimental results with the theoretical predictions, which is given by the green curve that you see over here. And of course, if you have low multiple moment, the variance is going to be larger. And you can see this green band that you have around the theoretical predictions. That's an interval of confidence at 95%. But now you can see that these red points here, they are slightly below the theoretical predictions. And when these results are reported, so scientists talked about the anomaly at low L. So they don't know whether the fact that all these points are slightly below the theoretical curve is a fluke or something that needs some theoretical explanation. And what I'm going to argue during my talk is that such an explanation can be given by the de Broglie-Bohm pilot wave theory. Indeed, you can see the de Broglie-Bohm pilot wave theory as an extension of quantum theory. It reproduces the prediction of quantum theory only in a very specific domain called the quantum equilibrium domain. But if you allow for the possibility of distributions in which the configurations are not distributed according to Born's law, then you have a much more general theory, which can, in principle, gives you an explanation for the anomaly that we see at low multiple moment. So here's the detailed contents of my talk. I will first give a brief presentation of the de Broglie-Bohm pilot wave theory. I will explain how it works for one particle. I will explain also what it means for a distribution to be in quantum non-equilibrium. That is, distribution in which the configurations are not distributing to psi squared. And I will explain why these distributions tend to relax to quantum equilibrium. Then I'll consider, I'll introduce a few notions about field on expanding space, which are relevant for the infiniton field. And then I'll get to the core of our result, in which we have obtained exact solution for the quantum field mode on expanding space. And we have shown that they are equivalent to the solutions that we have for a standard harmonic oscillator, but with a retarded time. And then I'll show you some numerical simulation in order to explain the anomaly that we see at low multiple moment. Okay. So the de Broglie-Bohm pilot wave theory. So basically, it says that the complete description of a system is given by a wave function, psi tx, but also by a configuration xt. Psi tx defines a velocity field on the configuration space. And if you know the position of your configuration at some initial time, ti, you can simply solve the equation of motion, and you get the trajectory of your configuration. So the trajectory is fully determined by the velocity field, and by the initial position xti. So this theory was first presented by De Bruijl during the fifth Solvay conference. But as Professor Coudet explained during his talk, this is not what he really had in mind. So for De Bruijl, what we know today as the De Bruijl-Bohm pilot wave theory is in fact a kind of degenerate double solution theory. So that's how he refers to it in his book. So later, the theory was rederived by David Bohm in a slightly different form. And Bohm also explained clearly how the prediction of standard quantum theory are reproduced. He made a very detailed analysis of a measurement-like situation. And he also extended the theory to bosonic quantum field theory. Later, again, you have the contribution of John Bell, who was also a strong advocate of the De Bruijl-Bohm pilot wave theory. And in fact, this theory is what motivated him in his discovery of the famous Bell inequality. So here are more details about this theory. In the case of a single particle. So if you have a single particle, it's completely described by a wave function psi, tx, and by a position xt. Psi tx will always evolve according to the Schrödinger equation, whereas the velocity of your particle is given by the standard current, J, divided by psi squared, evaluated at the actual position of the particle. Now, if you consider an ensemble in the De Bruijn-Bohm pilot wave theory, each element of your ensemble will be described by the same wave function, psi tx, but they will be described by a distribution of particle position, rho tx, which in principle is different from psi squared. So these are really two different notions, psi squared and the distribution of particle position, rho tx. But it's only if rho tx is equal to psi squared that the De Bruijn-Bohm pilot wave theory will reproduce the prediction of standard quantum theory. Another property of the De Bruijn-Bohm pilot wave theory is a property known as equivariance. What it means is that if you start from an ensemble in which all the particle positions are distributed according to psi squared for some initial time t, they will automatically be redistributed according to psi squared for any little time t prime. And this follows from the equation of motion of your theory. This is the exact mathematical statement. If you start from rho t0x equal to psi squared at the initial time, t0, you will have this property for any little time t. And this is why we refer to this distribution, psi squared, as the quantum equilibrium distribution. Because once you are in quantum equilibrium in the De Bruijn-Bohm pilot wave theory, you will remain in quantum equilibrium for any little time. But now let's consider a distribution in which the particle positions are not distributed according to psi squared. So let's say I have some wave function psi. Here you have a plot of psi squared. And each time you take an element of this ensemble, and if you make a measurement of position, let's say you find the position to be in the small packet. So that would be an example of quantum non-equilibrium distribution. But of course, these distributions, we don't see them around us today. So the only way to explain, well, the only way to allow their existence in the past is by invoking a process of relaxation. Process of relaxation would mean that if you start from a distribution different from psi squared at some initial time, t0, and if you let it evolve for some later time, the particles would redistribute themselves according to psi squared. And this process of relaxation is supported by various numerical simulations. And here I will present some simulations that were done by Valentini and Westman in 2005. What they did was to consider the simple case of a particle in a 2D box and to consider a wave function which is a superposition of the first 16 energy modes. So you have this superposition here. They also took some arbitrary phases, theta mn, and each branch in the wave function is equally weighted. That's how psi squared looked like at the initial time, t0, and that's what they took for the initial non-equilibrium density. So you see it's different from psi squared. So this density, it's simply the ground state squared. But now, let us evolve this distribution with time. So you see that as time goes by, this distribution, the non-equilibrium distribution, will resemble psi squared. And this is true after two periods. You start from this distribution different from psi squared, and you see, if you let it evolve, that it will soon look like the psi squared distribution. And this can be measured by a function called the H function. This H function is defined as follows. You coarse grain the non-equilibrium distribution. You divide by the coarse grain psi squared distribution. You take the logarithm. You multiply by the coarse grain non-equilibrium distribution, and this gives you the coarse grain H function. And this function will go to zero as rho tends to psi squared. Okay, this gives you an idea of what the non-equilibrium means in the de Broglie-Bohm pilot wave theory. Now, if there is a non-equilibrium in the early universe, we have to consider the case of the Flatton field on expanding space. So I will first introduce a few notions related to an expanding space, and then I will come to the definition of a quantum field mode of the inflaton field. So let's say you have a metric. It looks like the standard Minkowski metric, except that here you have a factor, AT, called the scale factor. And this factor is going to grow as space is expanding. For example, if you have a so-called radiation-dominated era, the scale factor is simply given by the square root of the time. Once you have fields on expanding space, you have to make a distinction between the coordinate distance and the physical distance. There should be. Well, basically here I had an animation showing that the physical wavelength is going to increase as the scale factor is increasing. But for some reason it doesn't work. But basically, the essential thing is that the physical wavelength is going to be proportional to the scale factor. The other notion that needs to be introduced is the Hubble parameter, h. It's equal to the time derivative of the scale factor divided by the scale factor itself. And this quantity measures the rate of expansion of the universe. You can also define another quantity called the Hubble radius, and it is given by the inverse of the Hubble parameter. So if you have, again, a radiation-dominated era, where A is given by the square root of T, then the Hubble radius is given by 2 times T. And this is the characteristic length, which depends on the scale factor, to which you can compare other physical wavelengths. For instance, if you have a physical wavelength which is smaller than the Hubble radius, you will call this mode a sub-Hubble mode. On the other hand, if the physical wavelength is larger than the Hubble radius, you will call this a super-Hubble mode. And here is how the scale factor evolves with time. You see, you have this phase right before the inflationary phase called the pre-inflation era. And here in my talk, I will assume that the pre-inflation era is a radiation-dominated era in which the scale factor is given by the square root of T. So you see here, let's assume that we have the same phase, the same era over here in the pre-inflation. If you start with a physical wavelength which is initially larger than the Hubble radius, you see that because the physical wavelength grows slowly than the Hubble radius, at some stage, you will have that the physical wavelength is exactly equal to the Hubble radius. And then the field mode is said to enter the Hubble radius. Okay, so these are the basic definitions for field on expanding space. Now I'll consider the case of the inflatant field on expanding space. But first of all, I'll consider the simplest case of a massless scalar field on Minkowski spacetime. So if you want to have the equation of evolution for your quantum field, you start from a Lagrangian in which you have a Minkowski metric, G mu nu. You do the Legendre transformation, and then you get some Hamiltonian density. You can also further decompose your field along Fourier modes. So phi kT, these would be the Fourier components of your fields, of your field phi tx. You can do another decomposition. You can decompose phi k into its real part and its imaginary part. And if you do these two substitutions, and if you replace into the Hamiltonian density, if you quantize the theory, what you find is that you have a set of 2D standard harmonic oscillator. One for each mode k. So the case of the massless scalar field on an expanding space is not much different. Okay. Okay, so it's not much different. Basically, you will have a correction to the Hamiltonian density. The scale factor is going to appear in here. And if you do the same derivation, in the end, you also find something that looks like a standard harmonic oscillator, except that now you have some time-dependent factor, A cubed, and A appearing where the frequency should appear. So what this harmonic oscillator is a standard harmonic oscillator, but with a time-dependent mass given by A cubed and a frequency equal to the norm of K divided by A. So now we know what it means what are the exact equation of motion for a quantum field on expanding space. This is simply a bunch of standard harmonic oscillator, one for each mode. And if we look back at the angular power spectrum, each of these values, CL, will be proportional to the variance of the inflaton field in the corresponding state. But now, since the inflaton field is simply a collection of harmonic oscillator, you know that the variance that you will have in this term is simply the width square of your state. And also, if you allow for the possibility of non-equilibrium, you can have a distribution different from psi squared. And if the width of your non-equilibrium distribution is smaller than the width of psi squared, you will find what you will have in the end is a reduction of the power spectrum by some factor xi k, which is only allowed by the fact that you have non-equilibrium in the pilot wave theory. So what we did in our paper was to find the exact solution for the time evolution of the wave function when the scale factor is proportional to the square root of t. And once we add these exact solutions, we have found a connection between these exact solutions and the solution of a standard harmonic oscillator. In fact, the solutions for the inflaton field are equivalent to the solution that we have for a standard harmonic oscillator with a non-time-dependent mass and non-time-dependent frequency, provided that this equivalent harmonic oscillator is running for a smaller amount of time that we call the retarded time. And here is a plot of the retarded time. This is this blue curve. Here you have the standard time. And for each value of the standard time, you get the corresponding value of the retarded time. Now I'll show you some relaxation simulation. Just one minute, okay. Quickly, some relaxation simulation, which will show you the difference between the standard harmonic oscillator and the standard harmonic oscillator with the retarded time. So I'll show you the evolution of a non-equilibrium distribution for a standard harmonic oscillator, which is non-retarded. So on the left-hand side, you have the non-equilibrium distribution, and on the right-hand side, you have the psi-squared distribution. And you see, as the non-equilibrium distribution evolves, it's going to look like psi squared. Very quickly. Now they are above approximately the equal to each other. Well, you see, now I'll show you the same simulation, but for a retarded harmonic oscillator. Well, you see that the non-equilibrium distribution is kind of frozen. For some large amount of time, it doesn't evolve. And in the end, the width of the non-equilibrium distribution is smaller than the width of the psi squared distribution. And this is what can explain the anomaly that has been seen in the power spectrum of the CMB. So I should probably stop here.